What's up, guys? Today I want to cover something I see a lot of people struggle with, and I'm hoping this video will kind of help you guys out. So the thing I see a lot is people having trouble setting up patches for their specific guitars, or you know, they have several guitars and one patch sounds good with this guitar but not this guitar. So hopefully today I'm going to be able to show you guys some tips and tricks to be able to set up patches for specific guitars. And also I'm going to go over setting up the Helix for a specific song, so having snapshots for each section of the song. So today we're going to be using the Yeatzee Guitar AC30 TV patch as the base. I'm going to use the S version, which is for brighter single coil pickups. But we're going to be using this guitar. This is my ES345. It's got humbuckers and it's kind of a darker guitar in general. So that'll be the first part, kind of setting up the patch for this guitar. And then we're going to set it up for a specific song. So in this case, we'll do Jesus I Come by Elevation Worship. So we'll go through the entire song. I'll kind of walk you through my thought process of setting up effects and snapshots, and then I'll do a playthrough. Before we go any further, as with all of my videos, if you look in the description box below, you'll see timestamps for every section of the video, so you can jump ahead to any portion you want to see. All right, let's get into it. Okay, so the very first thing we need to do is make sure we can accurately hear the tones. We don't want to make any changes to the patch unless we can accurately monitor the guitar signal. So there's a few different ways you could do that. I have studio monitors on either side of my desk here. They're JBL 305s. Very affordable, sound great, no complaints, highly recommend them. I also have a pair of headphones. For me personally, I go through the studio monitors maybe 20% of the time, and the rest I adjust through these headphones. So these are Behr Dynamic DT770s, but they're the 16 ohm model of the DT770. And if you've done any research on headphones, you're kind of scratching your head right now going, wait a second, I thought the Helix needed, you know, 90 ohm or more for the impedance. Well, this is my recommendation. I'm not going to go too into the weeds on this, but what I did is I took my Helix down to my local guitar center. I set up in their little studio section and I asked them to bring every pair of headphones they had. And I A-B'd them side by side by side by side using a patch I was very familiar with out of the PA I played out of most. And so I listened to every single pair of headphones, and this was the standout for me. By far, it was the clearest, most accurate sounding to my ears, and I went with them. I have no regrets. I have adjusted pretty much every single tone I've ever created through these. These are my primary way of doing that, so I would highly recommend them for that. I will say they're not the best headphones in general. They got, you know, a relatively short cable here. They're not the most comfortable, they're a little heavy, but just for purely listening and getting accurate tones, they're stellar. So my recommendation is to not listen to the internet and to actually go to a store where you can test out a bunch of different headphones. But I digress, let's move on. All right, so now that we have that figured out, let's go ahead and hear the clean tone and start working on the patch. So because this is the S version of my AC30 patch, it's set up for single coil guitars or brighter guitars that are lower output. So I already know it's probably going to be too much gain and probably it's going to be a little dark sounding. But let's just hear how it sounds on the bridge pickup, everything on full. So yeah, to me, I'm hearing there's too much lows, there's too much low mids going on. It doesn't really have a lot of sparkle or cut to it. And it seems like there's probably too much gain. Yeah. So right off the bat, you know, the things I want to change are to clear up the lows a little bit, give it a little more sparkle, and make it a little cleaner to start off with. And also feels a little... Yeah, feels a little squishy to me. So humbuckers compress more than single coil, so again, all of that makes sense. So the first thing I want to do is clear up the lows. So what I like to do is go over to the IR block here and raise the low cut up. It's currently set to 80 for the single coil version of my patch. We'll bring it up to 90, and we'll do the same thing over at the parametric EQ. So we'll raise the low cut up to 90, and that'll just clear some of the low lows for us. So you probably won't be able to hear a difference, but it'll help. So yeah, so not much of a difference, but it just, trust me, it helps. So next, let's go ahead and move on I could do a ton of adjustments in the parametric EQ, but the first thing I want to do after getting the low, the low cut set, is go over to the amp block and let's get the drive where we want it. This is important because as you adjust the gain of the amp, it's going to change the tonality of the amp. So if you raise the gain, you'll notice for most amps that the bass will become overwhelming and you have to drop the bass to compensate. So it's good to get the gain set where you want it right away. So it just sounds like it's a little too much for me for the bass tone, especially for the song we're playing. So let's just kind of... Yeah, it doesn't need to drop a whole lot, maybe 4 or 5. So it's at 4.8 right now. See how it sounds on the neck. Yeah, I think that's good. So now that we have the drive out of the way, we can focus on all the other things. So what I like to do personally for humbucker guitars is I like to cut a little bit of the low mids using the parametric EQ at the end of chain. So right now, we're actually boosting the low mids because for a single coil guitar, they're usually thin sounding. So you want to boost it a little bit to give the tone a little fatness. But we want to do the opposite with this guitar. So let's go ahead and drop the gain to -1 dB and let's hear how that sounds. So I'll bring it back to where it was so you can hear it. So definitely cleans it up a good amount. So we haven't done any EQ adjustments to the amp or anything. We're just dropping those low mids. What I actually like to do is for humbucker guitars, especially semi-hollow bodies, I find that they have a lot of buildup in the 250 to 400 hertz range. And I tend to raise the frequency level up to, 370-ish, somewhere in that range, and drop it by about a dB. I just think it kind of clears things up a little better. So this is what that sounds like. So immediately to me, it makes a big difference. It makes everything a lot clearer. It's a little thinner sounding, but didn't lose a ton of fatness. It just makes it focused a little more. So now let's go over to the amp block. I think we're okay with that. We can make more adjustments as we go along as well. So now after that, I want to adjust. Again, the low end is a little flubby to me. So we're going to go ahead and drop the bass down to, I don't know, we'll drop it there. So I just cleaned it up a little bit, got rid of the tubbiness. So these aren't massive differences I'm making, but the little bits count, especially when you're doing a lot of little changes. And then the other thing I like to do, so I was mentioning before that it feels a little squishy to me. And so what that is the sag parameter. So the sag parameter, as you raise it up, the amp compresses more and kind of caves in more as you play. So it kind of changes the feel, but also it adds in some low end as you raise the sag parameter. So if there's too much low end going on and it feels a little too squishy and compressed for you, the sag parameter is kind of a control to go to that'll make a big difference. So right now we have it set relatively high for single coil guitars. Because humbuckers compress more, I want to lower that. So let's go ahead and put it to its default, which is 5, and hear how that sounds. So that sounds a little too thin to me now. So we'll kind of split the difference to there. So you probably won't be able to hear it very much, but you can definitely feel it when you're playing it. So yeah, I think that's okay. So now that we have the low end figured out, the kind of compressed feeling of it, let's go ahead and adjust the EQ here on the amp block. So the cut control makes a massive difference on a Vox style amp. It doesn't take a lot to really make it sound totally different or fit your guitar better. So right now it's kind of in the halfway range. I know I'm going to want to drop it a bit. So let's just kind of try it a lot. So this is over a, so it was at around 5.5 to, so now it's about 4. So this is what it sounds like. So to me, that's, it's too much. I lost some of the girth. It's a little too sharp for me. So let's go and raise it back up to, I don't know, half of that. I think I'm pretty happy with that. I don't think it needs a lot of treble and presence adjustment. We'll maybe raise it just a touch. We'll raise both of them just a little bit. So I'm pretty happy with that tone. I think that's a good kind of solid starting point, bass tone, for us to build the preset for this song. So I think we're okay there. So the last thing we want to check for EQ are the overdrives. So we made some adjustments to the amps, and also the overdrives are set in my patch in the single coil version a little differently than the humbucker version. So we'll go over to our first stage overdrive here, the King of Tone Yellow, and hear how that sounds. So I'll turn it off. On. So I want it to be a little brighter, which it is, and just kind of add a little more gain. So I'm pretty happy with that. We can adjust it as we listen to the song and see how it fits, but I'm okay with that. Now the King of Tone Red is set to be a little warmer, fatter, more gain. So let's hear how that sounds. So to me, it's a little too muffled. So let's raise the tone up a little bit. And the presence up just a touch. I think that's okay. Again, we can make the more adjustments as we go, but I think that's all right. Then the TS-808 is my lead overdrive. So yeah, I want it to be a little louder, more gain, pretty bright. So let's hear how that sounds. Good enough. I think it's fine. So yeah, so that's pretty much all we need to do. One thing we could do is change the compressor because it's a little higher for the single coil version of this patch, but I actually think it sounds okay for this, for the song we're gonna be doing. Yeah, it feels pretty good. I'm using the studio compressor, so it's not super extreme, even on the single coil version. I don't like super compressed tones. That's just me. Okay, so now let's go ahead and listen to the song and start creating the different snapshots for each part of the song. Okay, so now let's set up this patch for the song we chose, which is Jesus I Come by Elevation Worship. It's in the key of D, and the BPM is 140 beats per minute. So the first thing I like to do is set up the tap here. Now, if a tempo is that fast, I like to half it. So I have it currently set to 70 BPM, half of 140. So we'll start on snapshot one, which is blank. All of these are blanks. We can set them up however we want for each part of the song. We'll kind of start with the beginning of the song and move our way through as we go. So let's go ahead and listen to the intro of the song, and then we'll set up the tones for it as we go. I'm gonna go ahead and put on headphones so I can listen to the song a little closer. So I'm gonna look a little goofy, but it's okay. It'll work better. Okay, so let's go ahead and listen to the intro of the song here. Okay, so the intro part, I know it's pretty simple. Basically, you're just playing this. So pretty simple part is just playing off the keys. I want my tone to be kind of ambient, not stick out a bunch, not super gainy, just kind of laid back, but just kind of just very wide. So just do that. We'll go over in snapshot one. The first thing I like to do for this kind of part is turn on the vibrato. So that just kind of adds a little movement to the sound, fattens up the tone a little bit, and I'll be in the middle position because it's nice and chimey. So you can hear just kind of a little wave to it. You can set it to assign the speed to be synced to the tempo, but I personally like it where it's set right now. So now we definitely want some reverb. So we'll turn on the mod verb, and I think we can get away with the big setting here. So just lots of reverb. Because we're not playing a super active part here, we can get away with a bigger reverb with more mix in the longer trail. Now let's go ahead and add in some delay. I think we could go with the dotted eighth delay here. Let's hear how that sounds. So I think that sounds pretty good, pretty happy with that. We'll call that our intro tone. So to name a snapshot on the Helix itself, you click preset button here, click rename snapshot and name it whatever you want. But because I have Helix Edit right here in front of me, I am just going to go ahead and name it here. So we'll call this intro. And we'll save it. So now it says intro. So now let's go ahead and move on to the next part. Let's go ahead and listen to that. Need your grace more than my words can say. Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. In all my weak. Okay, so this sounds pretty simple to me. I think we can stick on the intro tone, keep it simple. We'll switch to the neck pickup to be a little darker. And we're just accenting the chords. It's pretty simple. I think that'll be fine. They play it a little different than that. We'll see what I end up doing for the playthrough, but you get the idea. So I think that's good for verse one. Now we'll go over to the chorus tone. So the first chorus sounds like this. So for the first chorus, we keep it super simple and just do swells. We already have a swell snapshot ready to go. So it just sound like this. So that works, or we could follow the melody with the piano. So the first thing is we'll want some ambience. So we'll throw in the mod verb, and I think we'll throw in the dirty verb as well. So those together sound like this. So that sounds good. Let's turn on the vibrato. I just like it on. So that sounds good to me. Delay wise, I don't want a long delay kind of getting in the way of that part. I don't want it to have this big long trail. So for me, the memory man with that slapback style delay, I think we'll just kind of let it pop out a little bit more. So that sounds like this. I think that's great. We'll call that good for the first chorus. Okay, so after the chorus, it goes back into the exact same part as the intro. So we'll just reuse snapshot one for that part of the song. And then when it goes into verse two, we will go over to snapshot three. Okay, so let's go ahead and listen to verse two. we're following the vocal melody with doing some backing chords. Okay, so super simple. I think we could do something just like the intro tone, but a little bit different. So we want to keep it pretty ambient, so we'll turn on the mod verb, not the big setting like the intro. We'll keep it on medium, dirty verb, vibrato, and then the dotted eighth. And that will sound like this. I came up with this little part to play, so I'll do something along these lines. If I find it's a little dark, I might go in the middle position, which is chimier. And if I feel like when I'm doing the playthrough, I need a little bit more gain, I might turn on the King of Tone yellow on the neck. That sounds like this. So yeah, I think that'll work for verse two. So we'll turn off the King of Tone yellow because I think I will want the extra overdrive. We'll call that verse two. Go ahead and save that. I like to save all the time just so I don't lose anything. So now we will move on to the second chorus here. So let's go ahead and listen to what the second chorus sounds like. Okay, so I hear in this ear, there's kind of a lower thing going on here. And then the other one is kind of following the melody, playing some higher up stuff, and they're just kind of letting it ring out. So let's set up a tone for both so we can play both parts. We'll just kind of mix them in the playthrough. So for the second chorus, we'll do the kind of higher up part that's just kind of letting the notes ring out. So it sounds like they're just in the first position pentatonic, key of D, just doing these little dyads. So we want it to just ring out and just kind of bloom. So we will turn on the mod verb. We'll go big because we're not playing a bunch of parts in a row, just kind of letting it just sustain out. We'll do my longest delay I have, which is the dotted eighth. And I think I'll turn on the TS 808. So it just kind of blooms and just kind of, yeah, it just sounds big. So it sounds like this. Cool, that works. So we will go ahead and call that chorus 2.0. And we'll save that. Okay, so now let's go over to snapshot 5 and we'll set up this tone for the other part of the chorus, or for the other guitar part in the chorus. We'll go chorus 2.1. And the part kind of goes like this. So that tone would totally work. It doesn't really need much, but for the sake of this video, we'll do some changes. So the first thing is we can turn on the 1/8 digi, and so it sounds like this. So it just kind of adds a little stereo spread and doesn't really get in the way, so it sounds like this. Kick on our first stage overdrive, just to give a little grit. I think that would work. I don't think we need any extra reverb or anything. I think that'll be fine. We'll go ahead and save that. All right, let's go ahead and move on to the next part of the song. So let's go ahead and listen to the bridge now. Thank you, Jesus, just as I Okay, so it's just following the melody line, the piano. There's like a little slide swell thing in there, but I won't worry about that. So we'll go over to snapshot six, which is blank. So we'll go mod verb, dirty verb, vibrato. Just that's kind of my go-to for that kind of tone. And then for delay, I think we'll go slapback and the digi. So all of those together, that sounds like this. So the slapback is going to help the note pop a little bit, and then the digital delay is going to just give it some spread. So all of that together on the neck sounds like this. I think that works for the softer ambient part. Once it starts to get a little more intense, we'll change it up in a different snapshot. So we'll call this bridge soft. We'll save that. We'll go over to snapshot seven here. Okay, so as the bridge gets a little more intense, we will switch on, let's go key of tone red to give us just kind of a big fat round tone. And let's turn on the 1/8 digital delay, which I like to use for kind of these big driving parts. The delay doesn't get in the way, it just makes everything bigger. And then we'll turn on the dirty verb. And so that sounds like this. So I think that works. Okay, so now we're gonna do a complementary tone for a different part during the bridge where I'm just gonna do octaves following the melody line. So we're gonna switch over to the TS-808 for that part. We'll go to the dotted eighth delays instead of the digital delay, the eighth note digital delay, and then we'll turn on the big setting, which will increase the mix and decay of the dirty verb. So I don't need the mod verb on for this to do some changes to the sound. So all of that together sounds like this. So in isolation, that sounds a little crazy. The delays are really, really present there. But once it's in a mix, it's gonna complement the other bridge part I'm gonna play. And they'll be panned and it'll make more sense. And then also you'll notice that the delay sounds crazy in isolation, but in the mix, you'll probably barely even notice it. Okay, so we're on the home stretch now. Let's listen to the final chorus, see if there's anything different. So for the final chorus, we do a few things. We could play just like we did for the second chorus using this snapshot we already created, which had just for this part. We could do that, or we could do these kind of bigger key of D chords that are pretty popular. Or we could play a higher triads here. We have a lot of options. So I'm gonna go ahead and set up a tone for these, for this kind of sound. So we're gonna rock the same tone we had for the bridge when it got heavier. So that would be the eighth note digital, the dirty verb, and the key of tone red side. And so all of that together sounds like this. So it sounds sweet, but for the sake of the video, let's change it up a little bit. Let's go to the amp block and let's go ahead and raise the drive of the amp significantly. So right now it's at 4.8. Let's go up to, I don't know, 6.5. And so we're gonna get a little bit of a volume boost, which will kind of help match the whole band's volume because everyone's gonna be going really hard during this part. So it sounds like this. We'll be right back. super rocking tone. So not necessary, but yeah, we can totally do it. Super easy to adjust the drive and just kind of give it a little more if we want that. All right, so now there's just the outro. So the outro, we could either continue with the chords with the whole band and just kind of keep playing it super big, or we can go and play the melody of the song. Do either or. I'm not sure what I'm gonna do for the playthrough yet, but let's set up a tone for the kind of lead playing the melody in the outro. So we'll use the same exact tone we just set up for the final chorus. However, we'll do a couple little changes just because we can. So the first thing is I have in my patch here a volume gain block. So it's second to last in chain, and it's set to a 1.5 dB boost, which is perfect for just helping you pop through the mix for a solo. So I can just go ahead and turn this on for this snapshot I'm doing right now. And that will be help me to just poke out a little bit. We've already got the gain boosted on the amp. We've got the King of Tone red on. Let's go ahead and hear that sounds. Sounds sweet. Now, if I really wanted to get crazy, I could do a couple of things. I could stack on the TS-808 for tons and tons of gain, and also a little bit more mids. Basically infinite sustain as well. Another thing I could do is I could turn on the memory man, which is a slapback delay. And again, it'll just help me poke out just a little bit more. So with everything on, sounds like this. That's it. You can take this off. It's quite warm in here. I don't know how many of you guys made it this far with me, but if you did, thank you. I hope this video was helpful for you guys and kind of giving you some tips and tricks for setting up Helix patches for different guitars as well as for songs you're going to be playing. If you guys like the video, give it a thumbs up. If you really like the video, consider subscribing to my YouTube channel. I'm going to have a lot more videos coming in the near future. Super excited, got a lot of stuff in the works. And yeah, if you're interested in the patch, it's linked in the description below, or you can go to yeatseeguitar.com. It's the Yeatzee Guitar AC30TB preset. So we're gonna do the full playthrough now, and hope you guys dig it. Thanks guys, have a great day.
more Helix content, subscribe. If you liked the video, give it a thumbs up. If you didn't, drop me a comment. I'll see you guys.